small webframe in Python. So I started, recently started porting that into Python 3. Then I thought, let me give a talk to talk at Python about what's Python 3, etc. But I started porting that, and then I gave a pause, and then I haven't actually touched Python after that. Okay. So, but so don't keep your hopes too high, because I'm just going to give a small introduction to what is Python 3 and how it's different from Python 2. Okay. And so one of the things with Python 3 is it's released in 2008. Okay, 5 years. Okay, and how many of you tried Python 3? That is opened Python 3 and okay, that's okay. How many have actually written some programs actually like more than like 20 lines of code in Python 3? Awesome. Okay, and so see, you see, so Python 3 is there, and Python 3 is the future. Okay, all you know, and Python 2.7 is the last release of Python 2.x series. Okay, so. In a year or two, all of you are going to switch to Python 3. If you want to continue Python, you have to learn Python 3, whether it's good or bad. But just get a hang of what is Python 3. Okay. I mean, frankly, like I have not done anything, any long thing until I started porting this into Python 3. Okay. So, one of the problems is with Python 3 is just laziness. Okay. Why should we just write? Okay. Because I'm happy, my code is running. Okay. So, but I mean, as a developer, it's a little nice to actually know like what is there, and then how it's different, how is it good, how is it bad. When you want to port some project, what kind of issues we get. Okay. So this talk, I'm not going into so many details, but what I'll show you is it's kind of difference between Python 2 and 3. So we start with hello. Okay. Or just try, so this is Python. Oops. Sorry. Python 3. So one of the Python 3 is a backward incompatible release of Python. So there's a lot of baggage Python has accumulated from past, and they thought that some things which are important to fix. And fixing them, what it means that some of the existing code that's working will break. So what I've done is they've planned it carefully from the beginning, and then they've released their version for Python 3. And they continue developing Python 2 in parallel. Okay. So what they've done is they've made sure that it's easy to switch from Python 2 to Python. So let me show you the important things that actually syntax-wise is different. Okay. So when you write hello world in Python, print hello, right? So print. This won't work in Python 3. Okay. That's a syntax error. Okay. Why? So print was a statement in Python 2. Okay. So what I'll do is. I'll open Python 2.7 here, Python 3 here, okay. And so if you say print, okay, so that's how you do it in Python 2. In Python 3, this won't work. So it does print the function. Okay, want to print more things? So now, why is this important? When you see, like, does it really make any sense to have print as a function? But, so the thing is now, print is a statement, okay? That means, you can't say, let's say, instead of adding print, can I overwrite print with some other function? we can think of a case where it might be useful. What to over interpret with something else?
You want to write multiple sources.
Okay, so a good example is you write good GUI application, okay? But you want, when you people try print, it should actually come to the console at the bottom. So there's no terminal really, okay? So right if you want to do that, you have the monkey patch, this dot SD out, and whenever someone writes to that, you take that, and then, okay, it's such a pain, okay? But make print a function. Now, you put a different print, for example, I can write a x print, okay? That takes, just take one argument for now, okay? And then what I'll do is, I'll actually, I first need to copy the one print to print. And define x print, what it's do is print a code. It's a print equal to x print. Right? So now, when you customize print, okay, it's because it's a function, you can override with something. But also there are nice things that you get by having okay. Let's say I want to write this to 5 stuff, writing to std out. The way you do it is a print, let me import this. Say print so it actually goes to, well, it's printing here, but that's actually going to standard error of that. But if you do it in Python P, it's actually pretty nice. You can say file equal to sys.stdout, std, your stdout, sorry. So that's, there are things that you already know, okay? Function takes arguments and keyword arguments. So it just fits in very nicely. So that's one syntax, change in syntax. Yeah, so that's the thing. So what you can do now is, let me show you my, so this is the program that I have, okay? Now if I, so it's printing two things, hello world, and printing output as TV, okay? So if I run this now with Python 2.7, okay, it gives me an error. But if I work with Python 3, that works fine. Now, how do I write code which works in both? So what you can do is, Python provides a transpose for feature module to import the features you want to be supported in the expression so that you can actually write code to encode. Okay. So you can say import the print function. Okay. I have it. Okay. Now this code works in Python 3 and works in the code server. Okay. Show you code. Okay. So if you want to do something that work in both Python 2 and Python 3, you better add a command score feature, import print function, that will make sure that your code works in both. The other syntactic change is handling exceptions. Okay. Now, Python 2, you say accept exception, comma, e. Okay. You will inform by saying that as e. That's kind of nice. Okay. But the nice thing is they have started, so they support this from 2.6. So if you have a program that's, so this program runs without any change in 2.6. So 2.6 and 2.7. Python 2.7, exception is fine. Okay. So 1 by 0, that's an exception. So it's printing the error message there. Okay. So use the print statement of Python 3. Okay. Is that clear? Okay. There are some visible changes, okay? And there are a lot of, some of the changes, let me go back and speak of Python 2 or 7. Okay. So what do you write from 2 by 2? Python 2? 1? Okay.
Yeah.
What do you expect to be in Python 3? 1? Okay. Now, the division operator, okay, for new machines, it's actually very confusing. Okay? Sometimes it gives the 1.5, sometimes it gives 1. Okay, so what that is, they decided that it's not a good idea to have same operator for integer and integer encoding permutation. Okay? So they have a new operator. Okay? That's integer division. If you use 2 slash, that's integer division. Otherwise, it always does floating point division. Okay. Why? One is consistent, second is explicit is better than implicit. One of the philosophies of Python. Okay. So, font integer division, then say that explicitly that I want an integer division. These kind of things are small things, but they have working code, it's going to break them. Okay, so that's why Python 3 is a completely different thing. You have to spend time to port your code from Python 2 to Python 3. The other major, one of the biggest changes to Python 3 is if you have with Python 2, so x equals hello, what's type of files? That's a string. Okay, so let's say I have y equal to. So that's a Unicode character. Okay. So what we type of y? That's Unicode. Okay. Now, so one of the biggest changes in Python 3 is now they don't have string on Unicode. String is Unicode. Okay. So let's say x equal to hello. Let's see. Okay. And say y equal to y is. Okay. So they are unified strings. Okay. Now instead of having Unicode and ASCII, that's what we have in Python 2. Now what we propose is let's have text and data. Not Unicode and string, not Unicode and ASCII. What should we be dealing with is, are we dealing with text or dealing with data? Just these two things, okay? But really, it doesn't make sense to talk about ASCII encoding. Okay? Because when people, when this thing started, people were all using Latin as, or English as the only thing available those days. But now, a lot of people use so many different things. So, in Python 3, you have text and data. That's all. They're two different things, okay? But now, for that, they have. And they have added a binary type. Okay. This is a A. So what's type of what's A? A is a that's bytes. This is stream of bytes. Yeah.
In Python 2, there is a type like means, and here they are mentioning a class. So.
But so I'll come to that in a while. Okay. So there's something called used and overset classes. In Python 2, they have unified that in Python 3. Okay, so we'll come to that. Yeah, so that's one of the differences. Okay, so now it's going to create a lot of this is one of the pain points for going to Python 3. So now, what happens when you open a file? What is it going to give you bytes or string or text? So it's going to give you bytes or text, right? Bytes or text?
Bytes.
So the thing is now, you can open the file in the text mode or binary mode. Okay, so now when you open numbers.txt in the text mode. Okay, that's so like you have RB, you have RB now, that's read text, and that's got read. That gives you a string. Now, if you actually open this in read binary mode, okay? Now, the read text and the binary mode is actually Python 2 is only for Windows slash encoding, slash car slash encoding, nothing more in Python 2. But now it has a lot more, okay? Now, once you find read, it gives you one string. What it gives you is actually a byte string. Now, what is the encoding of? So, So you can actually specify what encoding you want. When you specify, you can say encoding equal to. If you have five different encoding, you can specify what encoding you have. It takes a converting environment. So, but the thing is now, you have to make a choice if you're really working with text or byte or data. Okay. Now there are times where it's not clear. Okay. For example, if you look at HTTP standard. Okay. HTTP is telling you text or data, HTTP headers. It's not clear.
Huh?
It's text, but so it's not really text. It's actually sometimes bytes. Okay. So. So the HTTP standard only works with live mode encoding. Okay, so all the headers are supposed to be that. If not one of them, you're not supposed to escape them. Okay. Now, when they come to Python, okay, so should you represent them as text or bytes? Okay, so there are some functions which work with strings, some works with the text. So there's a small computer mess. Okay, so it was a big mess in Python 3.0. They improved 3.1, 3.2, 3.3. It's not better than 3.3 now. Okay. For example, the bytes in Python 3, they started supporting a lot of functions of strings. So that a lot of things can do, for example, I guess we should be able to do things like can slice them. Okay. Can do all these functions that we used to do on strings. Okay. You can actually find index, all these things they are added recently in Python. Okay. Now it's a bit more easier to switch, okay. But still it's not there. Okay. Now, let's say you have a let's talk about STD out, okay. What will the encoding of STD out?
The terminal encoding. Whatever is there in whatever is successful.
Okay, now let's say I have a file, Python script, that reads whatever string coming in and then zips it or converts it. Compress that using zlib and then sends out. Okay, Unix, typical Unix filter, okay. Now, by default, the STDOut assumes that you're sending text. But now there are cases where I wanted to send data instead, right? So imagine a case I have a program which takes input from standard input, compress that using some compression algorithm, and then prints out standard output. So standard in and standard out here, both are dealing with data. Now you get into trouble. Okay. Well, there are ways to work and come around all that, but there are issues. Okay. So that's the one of the issues. Okay. Now there are some beautiful things that I'm finding. Okay. Let's say I have let's say this is a CSV file. Okay, the first column is name and the last column is email address. You don't care about anything in the middle. How do you take it from there? In Python 2, you have to split and then take the first one and the last one. Python 3, you can say split the comma. Right? So, I'm saying that whatever you split, I think the first one and the last one, remaining you put it in A. Okay. That's very useful. Okay, I really.
That deserves an applause.
Yeah, so it's so useful feature. Okay.
Yeah.
So,
star used to be a tuple.
Yes, that became a tuple, right? Oh, okay, it became a list here. Okay. No, star A is when it gets arguments, then works like that, okay?
Always
it's a list. No, it has different ways in different contexts, okay? Star A is basically you are capturing multiple things in one, okay? Okay. Now, the other thing is sets were added or added on to Python, they're not there from the beginning. Okay, how do you write a set? Write set, then you will respond to the property, okay? But see, what's, you see? Sets now have a first class. This is the set. But, okay. Like dictionary, you can write sets. So you have set literals in Python 3. And, let's take a dictionary. This one. Okay. let's say, let me just go back to Python 2, okay. How do you, I want to invert this, dictionary. I want to get values to keys and keys to values. How do you do that? Let's just, I have a dictionary key and value, okay. So what you probably do is, you do a list comprehension, okay. So you want take value comma k, okay, for the k comma v and v dot items. That will give you this page, okay. Now, you create a dictionary out of that. Okay, that's what you do, okay. But Python 3, all of you know list comprehensions? How many of you know list don't know list comprehensions? Okay, I'll just give a brief introduction to list comprehensions and then I'll come back to this, okay. So basically, list comprehensions are, let's say, it's done, it's a list, okay. Let's say I want to find squares of all these numbers. Can I for loop and then append and do all that, like the traditional C way, okay. But Python is much smart. You can say A way for A and X. Okay? That gives you all the squares. Let's see, only squares of even numbers. If A, 1, 2 equal to 0, that gives you squares of only even numbers. Okay? So, list comprehensions let you create a list on fly very easily. Okay? Now, we only have list comprehensions. We have added dictionary comprehensions in Python 3 for k, comma, b. In the appendix. It's nice, no? Okay. That is it. Okay. Now, you have list comprehensions and dictionary comprehensions. What's missing? Set comprehensions. Right? Why not set comprehensions? Okay. So, now you can do, let's say, let me put the one. Okay. So, I can say, take v, v dot items. Okay. That gives you. Set. So you have set comprehensions. Just like list comprehension, but you put case bracket, that becomes set comprehensions. Same well-known syntax, you can get a set, okay. A small little thing, but looks pretty nice. Now they have changed something. Now, one is there is a lot of functions used to return lists earlier. Now they return iterators. Okay. So, for example, in Python 2, when you say range 10, it gives you a list. Let's say I want to iterate over a million numbers and then do something. Okay. So for I range billion, it actually creates a list of size 1 million. Okay. Pretty useless. Because really not using them, just iterating them over it. Okay. Python 3, what people done in Python 2 is they created a function called xrange. It doesn't create a list, but it looks and works like a list. Okay. So with xrange, what you can do is you can say len of x, it gives you, you can actually say x of 0, that will give you x of 0, x of 4. You can do all these things. Okay. It works like a list, but it doesn't really create a list. So in Python 3, range gives you what extend gives you in Python. Also, when you have a dictionary like this, you have your keys that gives you all the keys of the dictionary. The dictionary things are not in order, so it gives any order, okay? Now, your keys creates a new list and gives you. Sometimes people thought it's too inefficient actually create a new list when you want to iterate over the keys. So what they did is, they created a function called iterkeys. That gives an iterator object. It goes over the element by element. Now in Python 3, you don't have keys. You only have iterator keys, but it's called keys. So when you call v.keys, that gives you, it doesn't give you a list, but it gives a keys like object. Okay. Now, for example, let me say k. Say k. Yeah, that gives an iterable object, so you can actually use it in a for loop, okay? Old habits are not gone. Okay? And so, that's one change, okay?
Those things, then we fucking find
What do you mean?
If I get an iterator object,
okay.
I cannot iterate over if I have a list and I want to go from the 5th to the 7th element.
No one. So the thing is now, what I do, let's say, what have all the keys on the list and then take the first key. Okay. So what you do is, you got keys, that gives you an iterator, okay. You wrap it in a list. If you want a list whenever, you wrap that in the list. That gives you the list.
And then I will perform those objects.
Then you can perform all those things. Okay, so that's so whenever you want converters, everything is iterated by default now. Most of the built-in things. When you want something, you wrap it in a list and then use it. Okay. Because most of times you use that as intermediate thing and then pass it on in some other computation. Okay. So that way that's usually more efficient than anything. Keyword called non-local. Some of these things have been ported back to Python 2.6 and 2.7. Okay. So non-local, what it does is, how many of you use global statement? Okay. Sometimes what you need to do is you might want to have a nested function. You want to change something defined in the scope above. Okay. So you can declare that as non-local, for example. I mean let's not get the super details, okay. That's one thing that I've added by the 3. Now, comes to the other thing. So in Python 2.2 or 2.3, okay. So the classes were so they had two different things. They had types, ability types, and user defined classes. They are completely different. So they have unified all of them by introducing a new concept called the user defined classes. So what I mean is, I'll show you what that means in Python Python 2, and then I'll come back to Python 3. So we're in Python 2. You write the class foo. What's type of f? What do you expect? Foo? Okay, call it an instance. Because but if you take a type of 1, just it's an integer. The difference is, so this is a classic Python classes. Okay. Everything has type constraints as an instance. Okay. I mean, you can get the class out of it, but so what they've done is, if you extend from any of the built-in types, okay. By class, anything that extends from object or any built-in class, built-in type, becomes a new set class. That's why if you don't write a new set class, write it, okay. So what are the differences? This is a silly difference, okay. But what are the differences? So one of the main differences, how the methods are, it's something called MRO, method resolution order. So let's say you have a class extends from two different parents, okay. If you call a method, how is that found? Okay. So in Python, in the old set classes, the implementation was very simple. What it does is a depth first search. I have a blackboard. What it does is, it's kind of hard to write that. Okay. So have class A, class A1 and A2. And A1 and A2, and you have a class B extended from both of these. Okay, so the way it looks at it is, let's say, and A1 is extending from, let's say P1, and A2 is extending from P2. Okay, so you have P1 is a base class for A1, P2 is base class for A2, and both of them, and B is extending from these two things. Okay, now when you try to find a method, okay, it doesn't have first search, it goes to A2. A1, and then P1, and then comes to A2, and then P2.
I think it's a breadth
first
search.
Means
A1, A2,
have
to write
first. No, I think it's breadth first. Well, I could draw. Yeah. So it's basically, it's not, No, it's not. I think it's up for search. Okay, so, and it does it. So ideally, you want to find that from the nearest parent. Function, if it's different from A1, A2, you want to go and find it from A2 rather than going, okay. And if both of these are extended from the same parent, then it's called a diamond. Basically, multiple inheritance is, at least, I don't like multiple inheritance. Don't try, I never try to use it, okay. The only time I really like to use multiple inheritance is when you're adding a mixin. Mixin is something which does not really a class, but provides some utility functions. Or get those utility functions available here, that's a mixin. So, yeah, so there are some differences, okay. Also, Python has some special methods. They're called underscore methods, okay. For example, you want to find length of an object, okay. For example, you wrote a matrix object, okay. You want to find length of it, there's a way to customize that, okay. So, the semantics of that are a bit weird with the original classes. For example, when you call x equal to 1, okay, and say, what it does when you call len of x, it goes to class of x and then finds a method underscore len and then calls that. Now in the old set classes, what happens is it doesn't call that method on the class, it calls on the object. For example, let's say foo dot underscore len equal to, forgive me if you don't understand what that does, because lambda is a simple way of writing a function, it's basically a function. So once the len of f equals to, ideally I want an underscore len to be there in the class, not in the object. That so, but old cell classes let you do this. Okay, that's bad for. I mean, it's not very consistent. Okay, if you do it for, if you do the same thing with b and len of b, it gives the bar doesn't support len, because this is the what we really want. Okay. So in Python 3, you have only new shell classes, you don't have old shell classes. They have been discarded completely. So whatever you write in Python 3 is an old shell class. Sorry, it is a new shell class. Okay. That's why, that's the reason when I saw here, you saw, let's say, type of 1. It's a type int and class int. Okay. So in Python 2, you have types and classes, they're two different things. Python 3, everything is a class. Even int is a class. Okay, there is no difference between them. This works, okay. With one old set and new set classes. Let me make a new set class, okay.
My question is that suppose you create a class,
yeah,
and after that you instantiate two objects on the
yeah,
and then you call say len method on it.
Yeah.
Now suppose the len method, the implementation that you want is that suppose I call len method on an object, then it should return the value of the object's specific attribute. Say you are creating a thing called say you
okay.
Create a
okay. Let me do one. I have a B1
yeah.
And B2. Okay. And then B2 you overwrite the response program. Okay. That gives you one instruction. Okay. B2 gives you okay. Now I print line of B1 and line of B2. Okay. So what do you expect? Is this the kind of question that you asked before?
Yeah, my question was that mostly, you know, at times when I suppose you are adding two, adding two objects.
Okay.
Right. At that point, you will be, you know, overriding the underscore add function. Right.
Yeah.
So at that point, it should pass the object rather than the class, because you're going to take some attribute of the object and then access it. Right? Suppose you create a custom date class.
Okay.
And you want to add two dates.
Okay.
And the addition of the two dates should be that from this date, add 1 year, and then you return back the result.
Okay.
Right? So in that case, you are actually not operating on the class, you are operating on the object.
That's true, but the thing is, underscore add is defined in the class, not monkey patch like this.
Okay. So now, if at all a person has underscore method overwritten in 2.6 or something, he will have to make them object specific in 2.7, otherwise they won't take the instance.
It's an instance method. I'm saying that, see, if you it's an instance method only. It's not a class method. Okay, when I say class method, I mean it has to be defined inside the class. Okay, for example, so what let me actually take this thing. Okay, Python minus IA, basically what it does is it executes that code and then gives you a prompt so that it can access what that is defined for. Okay, now we have bar. B1 and B2. Okay. So underscore. Basically, Python stores all the variables of the object in underscore date. So this, you see, this has a function underscore length here. Okay. Now, when you look at B1 underscore date, it will be empty because we have not added anything. When you look at B2, it has a length function which have overwritten. Okay. Now. So in Python 2, the default behavior is it looks at the object and takes it from the object. Okay. So then this actually, it takes this one. It's a new state class, it just takes that from the class. Okay.
So from the end user's perspective, if at all he's calling that function, he won't see a difference.
You don't see a difference, but the thing is, for implementation, okay. Now that probably looking at the class is more efficient than looking at the object and then getting it. So these are the main things. There are a lot of new things that have added. Okay, they have changed some of the bad design modules. Okay, for example, you have URL in URL 2. Some wrote URL 3 as well, but it's not in standard, unfortunately. Okay, so they have combined all of them and then made a new module. Okay, they have URL dot request URL dot pass. So URL URL 2 URL URL pass. All this they call club data single module URL. Okay. So there is some refactoring that these things have been there, scattered all around, they brought all of them together and then made it into a single module. Okay. So there are a lot of these kind of improvements there in Python 3. So we should give it a try and then see how it is. Okay. So what I feel is for whatever throwaway scripts that we are writing, we should try to do it in Python 3. The reason is we'll get to an idea of what Python 3 and how it's different, okay? There are some roadblocks. Okay, we're going to get to roadblocks sometime or other, okay? Because Python 3 is the future, right? So, two years from now, I hope 2 years, at least everyone says Python 3, okay? Maybe it's too early for Python production, I don't know, but at some point, all of you are going to switch to Python 3. So, why not get hang of it from now, okay? So I'm sure it's not worth doing it in production because there are a lot of third party libraries you're not ported, okay, and your company won't be comfortable to run them by the or but if you're writing some throwaway scripts, so it's a good idea to start experimenting with Python 3. And one thing that I missed is meta classes. Okay. So meta class actually is very hard to understand even Python 2. But just going to explain you bit of nice thing that I've done for meta classes. How many of you have written something about meta classes? Anyone? Okay. Sorry, excuse me for getting into meta classes, but let me show you. So I have a. There's one thing nice I wanted to show you. Can you see this? Stored for fun. Would be nice if Python has can declare types like that in Python. Not often we compare if you come to Java, C++. Say it's not types in Python. Okay. And surprise, that's why I program Python. Let me run it and try it. Okay. What is this? Okay, let me actually. How do you expect one to do this? What will happen if I do that? You got error?
String.
That's right. It doesn't mean anything. Okay. I just start. So this is actually Python hasn't got types in Python 3. Okay.
And what is the use of declaring?
Yeah. So they added something called function annotations. Okay. Now, so Python has blocks here, right? That's two numbers. Okay. And then that's an annotation to the function. That's a function documentation. Okay. Now Python 3 allowed you to specify annotations to so you can specify annotations for each parameter. Okay, so each argument that you're passing, and then for the whole function as well. So these things are accessible from the function object. Now, what Python does with that? No, Python doesn't do anything. It just gives you a place to provide you these things. Okay. Now I can write a function. Okay. Probably write decorator. Okay. Object. That be third party function. Okay. That looks at function annotation and makes sure that what you're calling is one of these things. Okay. But that's not. Python doesn't do anything. Python just provides you where to annotate all your arguments. Okay. So the way it works is. Let me try running it. Look at the function here, add. Okay. Here it basically shows you what all functions that it has. Okay. So now you can say look at add underscore underscore annotations. This can say x has I gave value in for y I gave that for return I gave that. Okay, that's all. So it doesn't do anything. Basically, gathers these things and someone can actually make use of them. For example, like write type check function, which will look at function and all the values and then decide does something. Okay. This need not be, this could really be anything, okay. I could just say two. Or I could just say just provide an expression, then it takes the expression and then puts the expression in annotation, function annotations. It's up to the whoever using it to decide how to make use of them. Okay.
From x, is it possible to get the annotation assigned with that? From x, is it possible to get the corresponding from x? X got annotation from 2 or something?
No. So x is, the annotations are on the function, not on the variable that you passed, okay?
Okay.
Right? So function definition has the annotations.
Okay.
When you call that, you call it multiplied with very different number of arguments.
Actually, my doubt is inside add, if you could be able to get the types of each and every variable,
what do we use of it?
Actually, see, if you put x colon int, okay. The inside function,
yeah.
if we could dynamically retrieve the annotations,
okay.
And we could make some type safe programming, right?
Actually, you already know what type is, because you already specified here, and the same code you are writing, okay? So you already know what is the type of it, okay? What is more useful is, you can write something like a type check, okay? That's a function, okay? What it does is, it's called decorator function, okay? So it's a function, decorator is a function which takes function as argument. When you write type check, what it does, it passes the add function as argument to that. And then, whatever it depends that is set in add, okay? So let me create a quick validator, okay? So writing a wrapper function takes two bits x and y. Now, what I do is, take the annotations, okay? If x is not equal to a of x, okay? I'm looking at the annotation of x, okay? restored this validation for that. Okay. Those have never used decorators like for this once I'm completely done the decorator. Let's try running this and see what happens. Yeah, sorry, it should be done the wrapper. It's an expected classic performed for this here. Okay. So basically it lets you write a third party things which can do type checking. Why type checking? It can do something even more, okay? Or type inference. I don't know, it can, it's completely wide open. Okay, you can do whatever you want with it. Okay. So basically what this does is this is called a decorator. So so what it does is this is equivalent to writing like this. Add equal to type check. Alright. That's a syntax for specifying that. Okay. In Python it's very common because what you want to do, you want to take a function or transform that into a different function. So what you're doing is you're taking a function which doesn't have any type checking, and you're transforming into a function which have type checking. And how does it work? It uses types that you have defined here. It uses the annotation that you have defined here for doing type checks. Okay. So Python doesn't have type checks, but it has now, since it has annotations, it's up to your creativity what you want. You want to type checking, type inference, and there are a lot of things that you can do with it now. That's type annotations. Any questions about annotations, function annotations? So now, now coming to, yeah, there's one thing that they've added is keyword arguments, okay. Now, I've seen, if you see the sort function, it takes a keyword argument called key, right? How many of you used sorted with the key thing? I'm just going to show you in Python 2.7, okay. How about, it's equal to, actually it's let's say if I sort them, it's actually sorting sorting consume the case. Let's say one sort is without consume the case. Okay. So what it does is it has a function called key. It takes a special argument called key. And you can specify that as a function. It takes called s. Okay. Basically, I'm saying that always sort on the lowercase value of the values. Okay. So it basically does that. Comparison without consuming this. Okay. Or I can say sort it based on length. Don't sort by name, but sort it based on length. Pass key comes in there. Okay. So this is an argument I'm passing by name. Okay. Similarly, I can have a just look at the first part, okay? The second argument, amon, can be either called by name or by position, okay? But sometimes, we have a core argument and there are options, but you want them to be called always by name. So what you can do with Python key is, you can actually say this, okay? Like the thing that you have done earlier, okay? So name star, this is the variable arguments, and then the keyword arguments. What are actually passed? You pass pi comma 3 now, they go into foo. But now I don't want variable arguments, but and I also want the amount to be passed only by name. I want to force that this is wrong. What we've done there, okay, here, this I want to not allow. Whenever I wanted to pass a second argument, that should be say amount equal to something. So they have an option to do that in Python 3, that's called keyword only arguments. So what you do is you say start. That means That's end of variable arguments. Okay, it's basically saying that I don't want to accept variable arguments. So when you have where adds amount can only be specified by name, because you specify position that goes into var args. Right? Now you want that, but you don't want var args. Right? So what I did is this. Okay, that means I don't want to accept var args, but everything else after that is a keyword only argument. So you can't do by comma 3. That gives an error. But you can do a x comma amount equal to 3. That kind of that's nice constraint. So everybody starts writing the code in the same way. Let's say you have a function which takes that like 2-3 usual arguments that it takes, but then it's also a couple of optional arguments. You can enforce that, they should only be my keyword. That's the part. And coming to meta classes. Now, how many of you you might have used meta classes but not written one? Okay. So, for example, it's very useful to write a class like that. Okay. Basically, giving a dummy example where you have a controller class and you define a get, a post, etc. methods on that. And then what it does is whenever you want to delegate it, it goes and calls that based on the URL. So what you do is you specify a path here and then ask it to take it from there, okay? But Python 3, what it does is you can actually pass those things at the time of class creation. And you see, when it's extends, you can say path equal to that, okay? So class creation can take parameters. Okay. So this is a code for that. So what you have is, in Python meta class is, if you look at a class, if you look at number 1, it's of type integer. What is type of int? It's something called a type. Okay. Or if you write a class foo, what will be type of foo? It will be the type. Okay. Now I want to write a class foo to, basically, so type is a class. Now can I create some other type? Can I extend from type and do something? And then have class of that. Okay. That's what meta class is. Okay. It basically gives you a hook to do some operations at the time of class creation. Okay. So that's what meta class does. I'm not going to go into details of that. So basically, it lets you pass parameterized class creation. Okay. When I'm creating a class, on say my path is this. Do this kind of things with Python 3. So that's basically things I want to cover with Python 3. Any questions?
So is there any difference in internals? Perl 2 internals versus Perl 3 internals. Python 2 internals and Python 3 internals.
Not much. So it's not a covered rewritten from scratch. Okay, it is an incremental step. Okay, so they have taken Python 2 code and then added this new feature and then made it Python 3.
So there is no architectural change.
Not too much. Okay, so if you look at now there is a lot of baggage in Python 2. It has support old set classes and new set classes. It has to support statements. Okay, so all these kind of things now, the code, I hope that code might have been actually become very simple now. Okay, right, because you do not support both old set and new set now. You can throw away that code.
Can you code some real time products which is in Python 3?
Python 3?
RSS feed.
Sorry?
RSS feed is in Python 3.
I don't know. So, I heard that it's a personal question. Dharanjay is running everything Python 3. I'm not sure. Dharanjay, who founded Python India in Pune, I heard that he's running Python 3 in production. I'm not sure. I haven't heard from him, but someone told me that he's running Python 3 in production.
He was chatting with me and he was sharing about a lot of libraries that he had been porting to.
Yeah, I know he has been porting, okay, but I'm not sure. I mean, someone told me that he's running Python 3 in production. Okay.
So Tornado website, Twisted website, twistedmatrix.com, that runs on Python 3.
Okay, yeah, very good.
If you have questions, please take the mic.
How is the performance?
Yeah. Mike?
He's asking how is the performance.
Okay, yeah. So, I don't know, that's something that we should really worry about. Okay.
Why?
No, there won't be too much of a difference. Okay. there is something it can improve over time. Okay, so I'm sure there won't. If there's a small performance degradation, it might be there for a reason. Okay, I'm saying that they're porting it to simplify code or something. Okay, but I don't see there will be too much of a performance difference between Python 4 and Python 3.
So global lock is still there, is it?
Yep.
Even in Python 3 also global lock.
Yeah, that's what it's saying. Unless you want to try Python.
Oh.
Actually, go with input lock is not really that bad. When people really get scared about it.
No, multi-threading we can't do, right? Even that. But multi-threading couldn't give much improvement.
No, so can you give me an example that you can't use in Python because...
No, whatever I read, they say...
To it's just feeding, okay. So, I'll tell you my practical experience, okay. So, I work on an Office Internet Archive. They have a project called Wayback Machine. So, what it does is, that's an archive of internet from 1995. You can go and look at snapshots from internet. So, they have a small piece of that called Live Proxy. What it does is, when you go and ask to show some URL back in time, if it's not there, what it does is, it goes and fetches it at that point and then archives it. So, I implemented, that was written in Java. So it was, they were having a lot of problems with that, okay. So, I implemented that in Python. So now, Python has GL, I mean, it's not good. So, the requirement is it should handle 200 requests per second. Python has low input lock, it's not good work. In fact, they should use green threads or they have all this libg where you should do all these things. So, like, they'll spend like 2-3 days trying out all these things and then actually start, let's actually see how the performance is, okay? That's not that. Actually works pretty well. Okay, so we need to the requirement was to support 200 processes, okay, 200 concurrent requests. So what we did is we started one process. We thought it's not scaling so well, so we split that into 4 different processes. Each process with 450 threads. So using USD with 4 processes and 50 threads in each process. So you have like 200 concurrent threads available all the time. No issues. Okay, I mean, 50 threads is quite good enough, okay, and it's working, okay, in production, without any trouble. So, most of the time people talk about, I'm sure there will be cases where that hurts you, okay, but most of the cases, okay, it's not going to bother you.
Python 3 had image package token, when I initially started using Python 3, the email thing was broken.
So what do you mean it was broken? It's not, you didn't find it in the right place, in the place that you expected?
No.
Or
parse email would not work. It will throw an error saying expected a string but got lost or something like that.
Yeah, so these things are now lot of internal events have changed too. Now I work with data text. So this thing, okay. It's very hard sometimes there's no clear line between the data or text. Right, so we're sending email, okay. Do they accept Unicode? Well, no, we're talking about text, okay. Do they accept text or data? Okay. But the standard says you have to send Latin word encoded or something, okay. Now, so there are parts of it where you pass data, okay. So basically library has been modeled to accept a string, but you're passing bytes. Or it's taking bytes, you're passing a text, okay. So you have to do the conversion yourself. Okay. So there are those pain points, so now you should know what is what, okay.
There was a huge thing in, we had written in Python 2 and we tried migrating to Python 3 and then...
Yeah, so the issues are like, there are some things, for example, some functions which work with both text and Unicode, okay. Now, when you pass, so now there is a return value for a function, you are not sure whether it's a string or bytes, okay. Right, so let's look at URL equal to URL encode or something that works both with text and data, both bytes and text, okay. Now, when you're importing some web code to that, okay, it's not clear whether you should use bytes or whether you should use strings, whether you use bytes or should use text, okay. For example, os.nlog, okay, is it supposed to be text or bytes? Environment of these things?
Text.
Well, I mean, consider it as text, okay. But what if you want to pass a binary thing? Well, it's perfectly valid. I can actually say slash x 04 or something as a variable. What's supposed to happen? Well, these are things that even I don't have a lot of experience with.
Thank you.
Okay.
So even in Python 3, ASCII and Unicode both are supported. Is it? It's
both are supported, but the thing is, by default everything is a ASCII string. It's a string object, okay? String object basically, it maintains one byte for each character. Okay, that's what is a string in Python.
Yeah.
Okay, and you have Unicode strings. Internet representation could be whatever, but that's what it's supposed to use when you want to work with Unicode.
But you have to depend with U something.
Yes, that's Unicode string. But Python 3, but everything is Unicode. Okay, so they wrote it. So now, Python 3, you talk about Unicode or ASCII. In ASCII, let's call it bytes. Okay, it's kind of a Latin word, which basically, Latin 1 is, you basically have 128 characters defined in ASCII. Latin 1 is, it basically adds some extensions and fills in the remaining 128 characters. That's Latin 1. Okay. So UTF-8 is an encoding for Unicode. What it does is, for all the first 256 bytes, it confirms Latin 1. So if you take ASCII and convert encode UTF-8, you're going to get the same thing. That way it's nice. Okay. So if you have an application that's written for ASCII, you want to port it to Unicode. Okay. For all the old data, it's going to work in exactly the same way, because UTF encoding will give the same values for all the old ones. Okay. So now in Python 2, we have string as default, and Unicode is something that you use when you want to work with Unicode. But Python 3, they made it that everything is text. Okay. So there could be some performance degradation, because now you are working with Unicode text always. Even if you know that your text is going to be ASCII always, you're going to work with Unicode. So it's going to probably take it more memory, it's going to take a little more time because you have to do these conversions, etc.
There is a package called 223, right? To
yeah.
Port.
Yeah. So I'm not planning to cover how to port like this. So it's a module called 223. What it does is it takes your Python 2 code, it converts to Python 3 code. Okay. So what it does is it basically, when you have print statement, it converts it to print function. So you have exception, comma, something, since as we have UR libdot, UR open, convert that UR libdot, UR parser, UR open, etc. We kind of picked some of the known things, okay? But it's not perfect, okay? So what I found is when I port some things, okay, it's actually better to actually do each thing manually, because you'll first actually get to know that where's the problem. And basically, you'll have that internalized. Over time, okay. If you relate by the 2 to 3, well, it does mechanically all those things, but you won't really. For example, I wouldn't know that I had to use your libdot request to import your load. But if 2 to 3 takes it, when does it itself, well, I wouldn't get that experience myself. Okay, I kind of feel that it's easy. And then personally, I feel doing it manually is kind of easier.
You can do a 2 to 3 and then do a JIT diff and see what are the changes that
you do. Well, unless you get your hands dirty, you don't really get that. You don't get internalized unless you try it yourself. Okay.
What are the important libraries that have already been ported?
Surprisingly, whatever library I want to use, it's already ported. Okay. Except the ones I'm maintaining.
So, NumPy, these are all ported, is it?
NumPy, I'm not sure. But Beautiful Soup is ported. Okay. I think Python Imaging Library is also ported. I'm not sure. So I think we're almost done with the questions. We'll make it up.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Are there any coding projects going on in which you can contribute?
Yeah, I think there are a lot of projects going on. I'm right now, I maintain web.py, I'm trying to port web.py. I did some part of it and then left it. And there's a test suite which needs to be ported. Okay. So one thing is, if you start using something, if you find that some library is not ported, okay, it's good to go and try to contribute, try to make it work in Python 3.
Yeah.
That's the best way, okay.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So can we port scripts in bytes too?
Maybe that's a good thing to actually try porting BOF at Python India.
Okay.
So we have an open space at Python India. There's one hall free and a lot of open space to sit around. So you can propose a porting BOF or Python 3 BOF and then sit, call people, sit around and then do some stuff.
Is the database
updates are there, right? Or what extension?
Yeah.
But these sort of things.
Yeah. So no, we have, so really people go there conference not to attend someone, and that's one part of it. But a lot of times people go hang around and sit and chat and then talk about new things. Okay. So probably put some address around. Imagine there's a lot of space. So I'm sure we'll be able to connect out of these kind of informal meetings. And there's a conference room if you want to give proper talks or something. So I think it's a good idea to keep that and then to propose it back up here. Yeah.
General question, how good does Python handle binary protocols? Say, say the syslog, in syslog there is already a module, yeah. But non-text protocols, right? How good is Python at handling?
So now, with the byte streams, it seems to be nice tools coming up, okay?
Right.
There's a presentation by David Beasley on Python PIO.
Okay.
It's an awesome presentation, okay? I think he gave it against Python 2002 or 2003, okay? So, so now all this I think you should just watch it. Okay, so he actually talks about how to parse binary things. So for example, you want to take fields from take first 2 bytes here and first 3 bytes, okay? So what he does is creates a slice object and use it as index. So you have byte stream, a row, which let's say is like 20 bytes long. First 3 bytes are meant for something and fourth and fifth are meant for something else, okay? So you create a slice object, call it, let's say first thing is header, second thing is third and fourth are body, okay, or length. Okay, it's a header equal to slice from 0 to 4. Okay, and length 3 to 4 to 6. And then say row header, it gives you the bytes of that. And then it's a row, okay. So I mean, it has nice things come up in Python 3, okay, with the bytes thing, okay. So there are, I mean, I'm not used to myself, so I can't really tell much about that, but I suggest you to look at that presentation by the way.
But how do you handle it? There are bit level stuff. See, if you take DNS, there are three bits long and those stuff.
Yeah, I mean, Haskell really rocks in doing them because they actually define
right.
All these things. Okay.
But how do you handle bits in Python?
I'm not sure. I've never done it. Okay. I don't know if there's something in Python 3 that supports it. I'm not sure.
Okay.
If you're wondering how to port an iterator to Python 3, there's a website called getpython3.net. In that website, there is a list of articles saying how to port your current existing library to Python 3, what all the libraries are already ported, and there are mailing list links out there so that you can, if you are stuck, you can write back to them and you can get it.
Yeah. The best Python porting tutorial I found is a blog post by Armin. He ported the Jinja class to Python 3 recently, and he wrote what he found more productive for him to do, okay. And I think even he suggested not to use Python 2 to 3, okay. So, for example, you have a code, sometimes you have to use conditions. For example, if Python 3, okay, for example, you are local, okay. You want to write same code that works in both Python 2 and Python 3. How do you do that? Okay, so what you do is you check Python version, okay. So now should you check if it's Python 2 or if you check Python 3? What's good? So I'll check if it's Python 2. Why? Because let's say Python 4 comes tomorrow. Okay. That code will break. But check for Python 3, that won't work for Python 4. Okay. What you should do is check if Python 2 from URLib import URL open. Else from URLib.request import URL open. So those kind of tricks. Okay. So search for Python 3 porting that. Go to Armin's blog, you'll find it. No more questions? Sorry, let's take a break. I guess food is ready. So.